I'd like to move to the environmental, and I went over this in depth last time. I recall seeing Mr. Hogan here, so I'll kind of give you just a quick recap of the environmental concerns. You'll see here, this right here is a wetland that traverses the property. It comes down through Mr. Fielding's property, and then when it floods, it ultimately touches Mr. Blaine's property as well. The fact that this wetland is in such close proximity to this proposed storage building and just the business in general causes great concern for the community, as I believe there's 11 or 12 wells dug around this wetland that services all of this small community. The risk that wetland gets contaminated with runoff from any of these units, again, I want to kind of emphasize the fact that these units smell, so they have fecal matter on them to an extent. If they are hosed off, if it rains, and this stuff runs down the property into this wetland, it will get in the wetland, and it will ultimately affect these citizens who depend on it for not only drinking, but for irrigating the crops, feeding their livestock. Multiple reasons why the risk far outweighs the convenience. Again, with the storage of the trucks on the property, any leak or ruptured tank could cause significant environmental issues. Also, like I said, when it floods, it stretches out. This is all flat out here, so when it floods, a lot of this is covered up. Mr. Bland, he's here today, he has cattle that graze out here, and if they were to drink any contaminated water and ultimately get infected, then that would end up in the supermarkets that we shop at. And again, we do have a pecan orchard right here. This is Mr. Fielding's pecan orchard here. We also had, and I'll get to it shortly, an illegal dump that took place somewhere in this area, in very close proximity to Mr. Fielding's pecans, which also not only caused concerns of contamination of the pecans that he plans on selling, but also worried him that something like this could happen again, and next time even worse. With that, I'll get off the environmental issues, but now I'd like to get to the moral opposition that we have. Mr. Coffin said last time that he wants to do things right and buy the book. And he'll likely get up here and tell you that again today. But we've compiled a list of what he hasn't done right or by the book that we're aware of at this time. Back in December, rather than request the variance and then act on the results of the variance, he moved his business over here, and then he asked for forgiveness, i.e. the variance request. He had the porta potty strewn in the yard in violation of the section that says no outside storage is permissible. They were also visible from the street, which was in violation of another standard. He had more employees than were allowed, and to the best of our knowledge, that hasn't been changed. That hasn't changed since. And he has had more trucks than were allowed, and to the best of our knowledge, that hasn't sense. He also conducted his business without proper permitting. Per the regulations of the Department of Public Health, Chapter 511-3-6-.05, subsection 3, his permit was to expire upon the change of his business location, which we're aware that it was previously on Ocean Pond Avenue in Lake Park, 8 miles away from his house here on Tucker Road. And thereafter, he conducted business, if only for a day, without proper permitting. Next, after the decision on the variance back in November, Mr. Coffin continued to employ a non-resident employee and allow more than two vehicles to be stored on his property. And those were the subject of his application in December. Yet, he continued to do it despite y'all's unanimous decision to deny that variance. He has cleaned the units at least once on his site, despite the fact that he says they're cleaned off-site. And this is evident by the neighbors who have reported hearing the distinct sound of a pressure washer hitting a large piece of of plastic, that being the porta potty. And again, if the units were truly cleaned off-site, there would be no need for a vegetative buffer to mitigate any smell, the fumes to which he alluded at our last meeting. And finally, this is the big one. Mr. Cawthorn, he admitted to illegally dumping because of an emergency. That an offense that is a felony in Georgia. And we're not here to get Mr. Cawthorn in trouble or anything, but it is a felony to illegally dump human waste on private property in Georgia. He also stated last meeting that he cleaned everything up. Well, we got a soil sample of the spot we thought was to be dumped on. It was, and I don't have a picture, I believe Mr. Fielding will have a picture for you shortly. It's a bare spot. There's a lot of grassland around it, and it's just a bare spot. We had a hunch that was where the dump occurred. We had a soil sample taken. That's the second exhibit in y'all's packet. We took that sample down to Gainesville to be tested, and they found relatively high levels of fecal coliform, which, to my non-biological knowledge, is human waste. Again, if this was cleaned up properly, we feel that, those soil samples would have shown a negative amount, or they would have been negative for any trace of fecal coliform. And all this happened within 1 year of him being on the property. If this is doing the right thing, then I can't imagine what the next 5, 10, 20 years has in store for this property, this wetland, this community, and the neighbors, if this home occupation is permitted to continue. And I've pointed out a few reasons why, well, more than a few reasons why this business should not be considered a home occupation in Lowndes County. And I feel that Mr. Cawthorn has only two reasons that he feels it should be. One being that he pays taxes on his property. Every landowner in Lowndes County pays taxes on their property. So that shouldn't be a basis for granting a home occupation. The next is for his convenience, which he stressed last time. He wanted everything under one roof. And we feel strongly that his convenience should not outweigh the safety, the peace of mind of the environment and the neighbors as a whole. So with that, I believe Mr. Fielding had a few things to say, unless y'all had any questions for me.
I got a question.
Yes, sir.
Are there currently porta potties stored on the property?
We are not aware of any currently stored on the property now. If there's some in a shop, I mean, he has a couple of buildings here. I believe this is his house. I think that's a little shop, and I'm really not sure what those are. But for Mr. Fielding, at this time, cannot see any porta potties from his house.
And where were the porta potties that were previously located on the property? Where were they lined up?
I believe they were lined up on this back fence line, or not fence line, just back row. We took pictures from Jumping Gully Road through the pecan trees, and you can see them there. And then I had Mr. Fielding come stand under the shade of this pecan tree, and they were a stone's throw away.
And do you know when they were removed?
They were also some stored in the wetlands.
Down here?
There were some.
Okay, yeah. Well, there you go. Yes, they were removed, I believe, a week or two after our December meeting last year. We don't know where they were taken. And again, Milo Sanitation still has property in their name at the Ocean Drive Avenue where this business was previously conducted. I believe last meeting, Mr. Cawthorn said he didn't have any other places to go or anything. I don't know if he's leasing this property or not, but he does have property zoned for this activity in his business's name, 8 miles away from his house.
Are they parking trucks on the property?
Yes, currently there's at least 2 trucks being parked, and they are in the rear yard as the standards require. However, we have had occasions where there have been more than two. I believe there's a couple of pump trucks, a flatbed that has maybe a tank on it for, you probably help me out more,
yeah,
a tank, and then another trailer, is that right?
Right, and then a Chevy truck pulls the trailer.
Okay. Which the Chevy truck could probably constitute a personal vehicle. But
it's for the business.
Oh, is it? Okay.
I do have a question about the pressure washers.
Yes, sir.
You, I remember you saying that you heard the sound of like pressure washers going off, and it was hitting against some, like maybe some plastic material or something. I just couldn't help but wonder, did anyone visual to see that? Or what, were they pressure washing the porta potties, or were they pressure washing the trucks? So I'm just kind of trying to.
Yeah, from during different times of the year, the foliage is dead. From the back part of my property, looking up, I could visibly see, but as far as me driving up there to walk up and no sir, but from afar I could see the operation.
Has this happened since our last meeting and since he moved everything off as far as storing porta potties?
I have not heard of pressure washer, pressure washing porta johns, but then again, you know, I have a job too, but I have not since the December meeting heard the washing of a porta potty.
For all practical purposes, at least that part right now.
Right now.
Since the porta potties are not there, he's not washing them there, so that part has been taken care of.
To the best of my knowledge.
But let me chime in there. That was when the porta potties were on the property. This home occupation would allow for those porta potties to be stored in an accessory building, in which case that cleaning of the porta potties would likely resume as they would be on the property, ready for storage.
I believe what we voted for in December specified no porta potties on the property at all.
Well,
the only thing I understood when we made the motion and passed it that he could store was two trucks and related items to that business for that two trucks.
Well, I believe the standards allow for, let's see. That just says outside storage is prohibited, but it allows for, Jay, a home occupation shall not be conducted in an accessory building, however, storage of materials is permissible. And it was our understanding that he planned on building a 900 square foot, three wall barn type structure to store these in. And again, he stated that he planned on building this vegetative buffer to reduce the fumes. I wouldn't consider a clean unit, I wouldn't expect an otherwise clean unit to produce fumes. So it's our opinion that these units either will not be cleaned, in which case they will need to be pressure washed, or they're just gonna stink to high heaven, especially when it gets hot. This odor is gonna be slowed by the vegetative buffer, but ultimately not completely cured. And again, that would be in violation of that standard, which prohibits nuisances.
Any other questions?
I have one more question.
Yes, sir.
So the only sampling that was taken was in December the 22nd of last year?
I believe that's right. Well, I don't know if it was.
Yeah.
Is that? Yeah, and then we took it in on the, they gave us our results on the 10th, so that's correct.
Okay, but none since then, just on this day?
No, well, none since then, but I mean, the area itself is Mr. Coffin explained this to the board last time. He had sediment that was deposited. When he pumps the trucks, I guess sand builds up in there. And then when you go to dump them, the sand is too heavy to go up through the tube, so it just settles at the bottom. And then once you have too much of that, the suction is compromised, and they have to get rid of that sediment. So he had an emergency situation in Cecil last year where it was a financial emergency, is what it was. He had to go service those units. So he pumped all of this sediment that was at the bottom of his tank, which holds the human waste. He pumped it all out, and we later found out on his own property, within 50 yards of these peak entries, dumped it on the ground. And the area is, from the picture, and I didn't have much of a reference, but from the picture it looked to be maybe 3 to 4 feet wide by maybe 10 to 12 feet long. I mean, it was enough sediment to back up a pump truck, and you've seen the big pump trucks. They're big units, so it wasn't like a 5 gallon bucket's worth. I'll take your question. If another sample was taken today, I'm 99% sure that it would show up positive for the fecal coliform.
Questions?
stated that they are in violation of the Department of Public Health rules and regulations. Has a complaint been made to the Department of Public Health?
I'm not sure. Yes.
Verbal.
A verbal complaint.
Several.
Okay. And is anything, do you know if they are doing anything about that?
They said they were trying to decide how they were going to handle this situation.
Okay.
Exactly, quote unquote, cop cottages words to me.
Okay. There was also a statement made about the dumping of waste and that it was a violation of the law. Has law enforcement been notified in any way of this?
No, sir. And again, that's not our intention. We are not trying to run the property into the ground. We are simply trying to keep this out of the neighborhood. We respect his business. We respect him as a person. We feel that this business is best situated for his particular land that he has, that he previously ran his business from. So to answer your question, no, it has not, and we do not intend to.
Can you explain to me what is the safety measurement system? I'm not familiar with this.
I'm not 100% familiar with it either. Mr. Blanda, I believe, pointed me to this. He may be able to answer a little more. I can tell you that it is,
you can pull up the DOT number and it'll take you to those stats.
Mm-hmm. It essentially,
now at this point, just to move us along a little bit,
hey Chair,
please keep in mind what
I'm so sorry to interrupt, but time is kind of the essence.
I understand, we've got to move on.
With the understanding that the chamber has read this room starting at 5, and they would like to get in here a little bit before if they know that there's a meeting going on. They have their
meeting
at 30. So they may be coming in just
to start finishing up. Well, where I'm going with this is, as far as what this board is looking at and what Carmelo ruled on, if he's not in compliance with the State Health Department or any of these other regulatory agencies, that's for them to handle with him. And it really doesn't affect us from the standpoint, in my mind at least, whether it's a home occupation or not. What we're concerned with right here, right now, is Carmelo's determination that within the confines of what she had to work with, that she felt like it did qualify as a home occupation. I understand a lot of your arguments, and we're getting in some gray areas, and it may be that that's a situation that county commission or the county manager or some of these people may have to get involved and give us some more clarification, or they start tweaking some of this language a little bit. But at this point, what we're looking at, it has been requested by this group that Carmela be found that she has overstepped and allowed something that shouldn't be allowed.
Yes, sir. And going back to your regulations comment, we understand that that's beyond y'all's control. We simply presented that to illustrate his non-compliance with rules and regulations. Obviously, this is heavily regulated. There's A through M standards, and that just kind of was to illustrate his lack of for lack of a better word, caring about the rules. In which case, like I said, 5, 10, 20 years down the road, these rules might just go by the wayside. So while we understand that y'all have no control over that, that was simply for illustrative purposes.
Yes, sir, you got
something? I was just going to say, I have a question for Carmela. Why is it the application? My understanding of I want to make sure I understand this application. If this application is ruled upon, are we ruling that Milo Sanitation does not comply as a home occupation, or are we ruling that a sanitation service does not comply as a home occupation, and thereby potentially affecting any other homes, sanitation service that might be working out of a home elsewhere in the county?
Yes, sir. Compliance is one thing. You all are ruling on whether a sanitation occupation qualifies as a home occupation.
So we could be potentially affecting any and all other sanitation services that are currently operating out of their homes, whether they are complying or not, throughout the entire rest of the county.
That's correct.
And everyone of them all.
And we can take code enforcement action on those that we find that he's not in violation. We can take code enforcement action. We can also look at if the business doesn't, in you all's estimation, doesn't qualify as a home occupation. There's several things that can happen. It's like a moving target. We can look at revoking the occupation tax registration. We can also look at, again, code enforcement action. But whatever you all decide is what the zoning office will enforce in the future.
If we said, so there are home occupations here in section blah, 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 B with a big list of things, mm-hmm. and then there's other things which you specifically mentioned that fall under the next section, section C, mm-hmm. yard maintenance, plumbers, electricians, who are not explicitly mentioned in section B but are in the gray area. So we're saying that home sanitation is also in that, as a county, right now home sanitation is in that electricians category.
Yes. Yes.
Could we know all of the businesses that are classified as home, business, sanitation? Could we get that information?
Yes.
Can I comment on that point?
Yes.
I'd like to stress the distinguishing factors of collecting, storing, and having units, porta potties that contain human waste, to an electrician's extra wires that he had.
So we're wanting to know how many other businesses are there in the county like this that, should we decide that human waste disposal is not a home occupation, how many other businesses are we affecting in our community? And
we can get that information.
We understand that this affects y'all, and that this is in relationship to this one particular person.
I understand.
But the decision that we're making here potentially affects a lot of other people.
I understand.
In the county.
Yes,
right. And really understanding what that general blob of things that go into category C, I mean, this is what Carmela does as her profession every day, and we need to, because we're the overruling authority, if you will, need to understand, you know, where does she draw that line? When y'all brought this issue up, we need to understand better where the line is.
Yes, ma'am, I understand.
Part of our problem here is we're getting sort of off task a little bit. We need to put the blinders on and say, okay, if Carmela made the reasonable decision and we backed it up, if there's other factors involved, if these people feel like they are not maintaining it, then they have to go another step or two to code enforcement or some of these other places. And if they're not doing it, then their next step, if they have exhausted all other steps, is to file suit and say, we made an error. And I'm not saying that I want them to go file suit and we made an error, but at the same time, we have to be careful when we say, all right, that's not a home occupation. All of a sudden, we're putting ourselves in a position and Carmela in a position that now, instead of us determining, does it fit, it becomes really hard on us to say, all right, you can't.
Right, that's why you say it, you draw the line to say these occupations are okay, where in section B it's very clearly said attorneys, drafters, realtors, blah, blah, blah. There's a long list. Then there's the miscellaneous, an interpretation that is not listed in that section, and is similar shall be based on acts and activities normally associated with the proposed use and similar. So we need to know what goes into category C. Karen Mellon needs to help us understand that. All the things that go in category C, which she's named some of them, plumbers, electricians, and yard maintenance. So that we can understand, is that really an interpretation that's similar to those tasks and activities? Like, is the disposal of human waste similar in activities to a nail technician or a beauty parlor with one station and its home? So I really need more information. I need a lot of information.
Well, at this point, it sounds like we're getting close to an impasse. So we have to try to table this, but from a legal standpoint, if we table this and start into this again, what does that do with the timeline that they're faced with?
This is an appeal. It's under a different timeline.
Yeah.
As long as it's under appeal, they're not...
It can go on indefinitely.
And that's one thing we're worried about, is that this is going to...
And if it's on appeal, then if anybody here hears pressure washing or you've got a problem, then you got to raise your hand and say, hey, something's going on over here. And he knows, what he said right here, and he knows that we've said you can't do this.
Yes, sir. And again, y'all said he couldn't have more than one employee, and he continues to do it. And that's our fear, that this is just going to... continue to go because the similar uses.
But here again, now we're getting into some of the areas that
I think what we're talking about is code enforcement, not necessarily
affirming
or reversing a decision made by Carmel.
Right, we're getting off path right now. We're talking about.
I think the and this is just my personal opinion. The step they ought to take would be to seek injunctive relief in Superior Court based on their violations of the code, as opposed to, because in theory, any you could have a waste disposal company and just do bookkeeping there and then have a facility off-site and be in compliance with the rules and regulations. So,
and we're fine with that. We're right. More opposed to an accessory right. building, storage, pump trucks. Well, we are fine with keeping the bookkeeping, him keeping his business at Ocean Pond Avenue and him conducting all of his books in his house. We absolutely would approve of that. Our issue is this huge environmental risk of letting human feces trickle down the hill into this water that we're not going to suffer the effects for another 5 years. And then 5 years from then, it's going to be too late. And then this lady's going to get sick, and this lady's going to get sick. And then it's, wow, how did we get to this?
But it's up to code enforcement or somebody to prove that this is actually still happening.
Yes, sir. But given the fact that code enforcement is citizen complaint driven, we feel that we might be at work one day when the pressure washer's going off and the poop's trickling down to the wetland. So given that code enforcement isn't, they don't have enough manpower to do this on their own to really do what needs to be done, and we understand they're understaffed, we did it. But given the nature of the citizen complaint-driven code enforcement, it seems kind of like a futile effort that will never be recognized until it's too late. And once it's too late, it's too late.
I have a comment about code enforcement.
Okay.
Well, no offense to code enforcement, but I know it is complaint driven. They've got a very limited staff. And like Carmela said, often they give the person that's been complained about notice that they're coming. Same with a nursing home or other facilities. They warn them. I don't know what the reason for inspection or whatever is when you're giving somebody a warning that you're coming. So
I'm just thinking that the proper forum for this, if you feel like there's been a trespass or a nuisance, these are causes of action that you would bring up in a you know, basically you would bring this up to the Superior Court judge.
Right.
As opposed to bring it in front of us as to, you know, because he's violated the code, so to speak, in the what he's supposed to do and what he's not supposed to be doing.
Yes, sir.
If you feel like you have a cause of action for a trespass or a nuisance, I think that that you ought to be seeking injunctive relief, equitable relief, from the jurisdiction of the courts.
Right. But at this time, we don't have a nuisance. We have a potential nuisance. And therefore, our case would not be right for the Superior Court at this time. We would have to let him construct his, and again, we don't want him to invest this time and money into something that is ultimately stripped from him. We would have to wait for him to build this three-sided barn and put those units in and let the fumes rise to the top in the middle of the 100-degree South Georgia heat and then pass on to his property before we could do anything. And we felt like we had a right to appeal this decision. We felt that an appeal of this decision at this time was most appropriate as opposed to taking to the Superior Court. Ultimately, we will if we have to, but we feel like this could be handled much more expeditiously through the Zoning Board of Appeals than would be the Superior Court. And again, our case is not right to be heard by the Superior Court now. It would cause a very large financial investment by Mr. Coffrin to create that rightness, if you would.
I've got a question for Cornell.
Okay.
I thought our task today was to determine if Mr. Coffrin's business comes under the category of a home occupation, period. And that you made this call, even though there was not concrete, you had to just use your discretion. And that we are to look at this like we would a staff recommendation on granting a variance. Sometimes y'all recommend approval and we deny. Sometimes you recommend denial, we approve. That your call was simply your call, and that we have the task of looking at the facts. We haven't had a chance to ask Mr. Coffrin some questions, which I've got three or four. And from that only decide, is this home occupation or is it not? Period. End of subject.
That is my understanding. Whether to affirm my decision,
all right.
And the violations is that.
And it's no disrespect to you on your call. Absolutely. It's just what we as a body look at.
But it's not whether his individual
is home occupation.
It's whether a septic service is a home occupation.
Right, right.
Not just his, all.
Yeah, for all of them.
Right.
And
well, our appeal was limited to this instance. And if that helps, if it keeps any precedent from happening in the future, our appeal was not for this business in general in all of Lowndes County. This was for this man, this business on this property with that wetland in close proximity.
Yes. But that still, it is going to affect the greater thing.
It will.
But if you were to give a variance to someone that, because they had certain aspects of their land, that wouldn't necessarily automatically.
Just because we granted this one over here does not create the precedence that is granted over here.
Correct.
But the same thing, just because it was denied over here does not mean that it's denied over there.
Correct. So how does that apply?
You know, the board has to look at each individual case.
Yes, sir.
And right now, our question is, do we feel like Carmella used the best that she could to make the decision, and it didn't satisfy some people, and it's not going to satisfy everybody all the time? Or do we feel like there was an error? That's why I said a minute ago, we need to put the blinders back on and say, look, we're talking about this one call that Carmella made, and either we vote to affirm it, or we vote not to affirm it. And then the chips have to fall where the chips have to fall.
Yes. Okay.
I think we have to look at the circumstances under which Carmella made the decision.
So when she decided that the septic tank service was a home occupation, all she had to go off of was that the name of it is Milo Septic Tank Service. She didn't have any clue about the specifics of the property or the specifics of, you know, where all the porta potties were going to be stored or how many trucks were going to be in the yard or, you know, the number of employees or anything. She just went based off the name. And based upon that, I think it does have an impact upon all these other similarly type situated businesses in the county. And when you start looking at it from the standpoint of, does it have an impact on all these other businesses too? I wonder, did we give proper notice to all these other parties to have an opportunity to come in here and be heard and make their arguments for us? Because, I mean, if they're going to be affected too, is just putting a red sign up by the road, is that enough for them? Because, I mean, they've really got a vested interest in what we're deciding.
Looking only at this case, never mind all human waste disposals, your specific objections are to that there are employees who are live outside of the home. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And that they have more than two vehicles.
Yes, ma'am. That's two of our objections.
Okay. On this exact list.
Yes.
Which were other ones?
We also object to number C, or letter C, excuse me, that it be incidental. The two huge pump trucks in your yard makes your house look like a commercial business, no longer a residential dwelling. D, for the same reason. H, for the nuisance. And those were our objections to the standards. Okay. We also pointed out our issue with it not being a per se home occupation under 5001B, nor similar.
I'm just looking at this list that you used.
B, C, D, H, and K were our strongest arguments. We didn't address ones that
thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, we have to be careful. You've got a guy that's in the well-doing business. He works out of his house. He's got 5 acres and he's got two well-drilling rigs, or one well-drilling rig and a tank truck and all that he uses with it. Is still sitting there. Whether it's a sanitation truck or a well drilling truck, we still got two big trucks.
I was just clarifying which things did he think that she did incorrectly, that she didn't apply, or that Mr. Kaufman's not following the rules for home occupation. Just was trying to clarify. I still also do want to hear from Mr. Kaufman today.
Yeah.
Okay, do we get to it? Because we might want to ask you. I want to ask.
We're running out of time, and the question is fast going to have to be decided. Are we going to postpone this? Or are we going to try to talk here? Are we going to try to talk somewhere else? I'm sure Mr. Coughlin wants to get up and talk, or he's going to want to talk for probably an extended period of time to answer a lot of this stuff. So if the board at this point wants to take a vote on postponing, then I'll open the floor for the postponement, table it until the next regularly scheduled meeting. I don't know how well it's going to fly, but otherwise we need to see about finding somewhere else to go to let Mr. Coffin have a say. And I don't know whether we're going to find anywhere else to go right here at the last minute.
I can help him set up for the next meeting. We can cut it in 15 minutes of their setup time. I can stay. I'm sure.
I don't know where else we're going to go to find the room.
Okay. Well, I'm saying if we can stay until 5:15. We could give them some hands to help clean up, just so we can get everybody heard today.
All right. I'm going to open the floor for a motion to see if anybody makes a motion, and if it will fly. If it doesn't fly, then we'll try to figure out something.
I'll make a motion to table this till next month.
No, I second that motion.
I want to add a condition on that. I think we should look into the whole issue of what other septic tank businesses are in this county that are operating under a home occupation license. And if there are any, I think we need to send them a letter saying what the repercussions of the decision that we're going to make are going to be, that they have an opportunity to come here and stand with Mr. Coughlin and make their argument. I think we should put that condition on the table.
We can have that information hopefully in a short period of time, Carmella can then try to notify these people of the pending meeting if that's what the board wants to do. All right, open the floor for any motion.
We have a second.
All in favor of tabling until the next regularly scheduled meeting, raise a hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. All opposed? 4-3. All right. We passed as far as a motion to table until the next regularly scheduled meeting. I understand it's not what everybody wanted, but for the interest of time and give everybody a chance to talk, we need to do something else. Okay. Minutes. Anybody? Motion on minutes.
Make a motion. Unless anybody's got any changes, I make a motion.
I have a second. All in favor, raise a hand. New business, any new business, old business?
I don't have any.
All right, stand adjourned.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.